Okay, fine. Welcome to the training. And before I actually start with the Selenium training, do you have any questions? Any questions from your side regarding the course, regarding the training? Okay, regarding Selenium as a tool. Okay. How do I simulate combination of keys like Alt Enter A? There's a keys class in Selenium WebDriver. There's a chord function in it, and you can pass over the keys in this. Just read on this Google keys.chord function, you will get to know about it. Okay, I'll be talking about this in the training, right? But if you have general questions as a tool about Selenium, what it is and all. So I'll just cover that briefly. I am sorry about that background noise. There will be, I guess, some background noise, but I cannot help it, guys. So, right now, basically, Selenium as a tool, okay, it is not a single tool. It's got many things inside it. Okay. There is, Selenium is not a single tool. When it came up in the market earlier, way back, many years back, 4-5 years back, it had known, it has something called a Selenium RC, ID is there and grid was there. Okay, ID was there to test your websites on Mozilla, but RC could test your websites on Mozilla, then it can test on IE, then it can test on Chrome. Okay, will you teach us the Selenium? Yeah, that's what I'm going to teach you. That's exactly what I'm going to teach you in the course, Asha. Fine. So, as I was telling you, when Selenium came up in the market, these were the tools. RC was there, Mozilla was there, these were the browsers. And RC also supported Safari browser as well, that was supported. Now, RC could be implemented in many programming languages. Like you could use Java language to write the Selenium RC code. You could write C sharp code. Then you can write Ruby. You could write code in Python. You could write code in PHP. Selenium can be using RC. It can be implemented in any of the languages. Right? It does not matter. Sometimes people think that if the website is made in PHP, that is the application under test, the website, it is being made in PHP, then I need to use Selenium with PHP language. No, it's not like that. It doesn't matter if your website is made in .NET, PHP, any language, Java, you can use any extension of Selenium to test. But the extension of Selenium with Java is the most famous one, and there's a lot of help available with the Java extension. Okay, and there's one more thing that out here, Selenium is only for web-based applications. Only for web-based. Okay, if you open up the browser and go to Selenium website, the first line it says is, if you go to the Selenium website, if you write google.com and download Selenium and okay, for this, if you go to the home page, if the first line which is written is that Selenium automates browsers. Okay, Selenium automates browsers, that means Selenium is a browser automation testing tool. Okay, so now it's not fair if they're for your desktop based applications and all. You cannot test those applications with Selenium. You can only test the browsers with Selenium. Okay, especially, you know, these days capabilities of Android testing and iPhone testing have also come up in Selenium. I think Priyanka was asking me about it. The drivers are there, but they are not so stable. Okay, and moreover, on Android and iPhone, you cannot test Android and iPhone applications. You can only test the browser. That is how your website is opening in Android, how your website is opening in iPhone. You cannot test the game or some application on Android or iPhone. It's not like that. Okay. Now coming back to the diagram which I had made. So this is what initially was there in the market. Now Selenium as a tool was made by ThoughtWorks initially. I worked on it for the first time in 2007. Right, and they made for their own internal testing purpose. They never knew that this tool is going to go so big in the market, right? And when it went into the market, this people realized, especially people from Google, they realized that there is a lot of drawbacks out here in this tool. So something new was made, right? And that new thing out here is known as WebDriver. WebDriver, I'm sorry about this. WebDriver can also be implemented in any of these languages like Java, C Sharp, Ruby, Python, Perl. So what happened was that this was RC. Okay, and after RC, things started moving towards WebDriver. Rather, they have moved. Now, WebDriver removed lots of drawbacks which were there in RC. Okay, sorry for that particular line. Accidentally, I wrote. Right. Now, WebDriver removed lot of drawbacks in RC. There were various drawbacks in RC, like you had to start the Selenium server every time. On your machine, you have to start the server. Sometimes the server never used to get started. So you need to empty the ports. You need to have restart Eclipse or restart your machine sometimes. So there were a lot of drawbacks. Okay. Now web, and there were like various things which were not possible in RC. For example, a very basic stuff in automation, that is, you need to go on a web page. Okay, and you need to print the names of all the links present on the web page. Just a simple exercise which is possible with all the automation tools. In Selenium RC, there was no command for that. People had to write some JavaScript coding for that. So all these things, all the drawbacks were actually removed by people in WebDriver. Okay, and things have started moving towards WebDriver now. And in market, what has happened is, initially, hold on, there was Grid out here. Grid is used to execute your test cases parallelly across multiple systems. You have got one machine and you connect that, make that machine hub connected to multiple machines. You parallelly run your test cases. This saves a lot of time if you have lots of test cases to execute. Now Grid, now these days something known as Grid 2 has come up, which works with WebDriver. Okay. Grid 1 was for the RC. Okay. Now the thing is that WebDriver as a tool, it also works across multiple browsers. It works on Mozilla, it works on Chrome, IE, it works on Safari, but with the Safari driver in WebDriver is still unstable. They are working on it. Okay, it's not so stable. Right, IDE remains same. It is a tool which will only, it's a kind of record and run tool. Right, now that's what I was telling you. Selenium simply is not a single tool. There are a lot of parts in Selenium. There are a lot of things in Selenium. Right. Now in this course, we'll be learning about WebDriver. You don't need to know the knowledge. You don't need to have the knowledge of RC in order to learn WebDriver. WebDriver is not built on top of RC. WebDriver is a completely different tool. RC and WebDriver, they don't have any common commands or something. There is no similarity. People who have worked on Selenium RC, when they look at the WebDriver code, they are not at all able to understand anything. Okay, these are two completely different tools. They are not related to each other. Right. RC is now obsolete. Development has stopped on it. The support has stopped on it. those guys, they have just dumped it, right? But still, some many companies use RC because their systems have already been implemented in Selenium RC. Okay, so now what we'll do is we'll start with the training, but before that, anybody having any questions? Anybody with any questions regarding the training or something? Regarding Selenium, anything? Right, so what I'll do is, fine. Right. So I'll just tell you, I hope Java is installed on everybody's system, because in order to join the WebEx session you need Java. And hold on. Yeah. Now to write Selenium code you can either use Eclipse or you can use WebDriver. So sorry, you can use NetBeans. Okay. So I don't know who they are. Okay, fine. Now, it's better to use Eclipse as a tool to write Selenium code, because it's simple, it's straightforward, it's to the point. NetBeans is quite complex. What do you mean by editor and Eclipse and all? Many of you might have studied the C language. While studying the C language, you use Turbo C to write code. Similarly, the Java code we are, okay, the Java code is written in Eclipse. We are going to learn Selenium with Java in this course. Okay, so all you need to do is that you can write download Eclipse. Okay, you go here and download Eclipse. Okay, question being asked is there any way to integrate, you know, there is a way to integrate HPQC with Selenium. Yes, there is a way, Siddharth, right? But it's illegal, I guess. It is illegal, I guess, because Selenium is not their tool. There is something known as QCOTA, Open Test Architecture, in which you can write VBScript code. When I used to work with QTP, I used to connect QC with QTP using that OTA, right? Same OTA, Open Test Architecture of QC, can be used to connect QC with any other tool other than QTP. But I don't think so that is legal, because there is a legality involved over there, you can check out. If it's legal, then you can come back to me, I'll tell you how to connect it. It's very simple. Right? I can make videos on QC integration with Selenium very easily, but I have not put it on my website just because of this reason. Okay. Just a minute, guys. What's the URL for today's training? Just a minute, I'll just give them the URL. Sharing back my desktop. Okay, now you go to this link, fine, and there is a 32-bit PC version and 64-bit version out here for Eclipse ID for Java EE developers. You download the one which you want. In case you have a 64-bit machine, then please listen to this carefully. In case you are having a 64-bit machine, then you need to install JDK on your system. Okay, download JDK on your system and install it in case you have a 64-bit machine. Right. Once you have downloaded Eclipse, right, out here in your system, you will have this Eclipse folder when you extract the file, eclipse.rar. This kind of file will be generated. Okay. Now this folder, you will get Eclipse, and inside Eclipse, you will find this eclipse.exe file. Eclipse is a, you can say it is a, it comes as a bundle, it's not installable. Okay, it comes as a bundle. So out here when you start it, you get this workspace launcher. This is the window where you will tell Eclipse that you need to store all the code which you will work with in Eclipse. Okay, this is known as your workplace. I'll create a new workspace called as September weekend. Okay, and I'll start my Eclipse right now. Just hold on, let it start. Make sure that you have installed JDK if you have a 64-bit machine, otherwise Eclipse will not start. Okay, you get this welcome screen, close this welcome screen, and this is the Java editor. Out here you will be writing the Java code in the central portion, right? You will be writing the code. Out here you will have the projects. In the bottom side you will get the output. Fine. Now, why is Java necessary? I'll start with Java. I'll not directly jump over to Selenium. I'll be going with Selenium gradually, maybe by the end of the session or tomorrow. This is because most of the people make this mistake that they don't concentrate on Java. Look, Java is the backbone. All you write is Java code in Eclipse when you execute that Java code, Selenium executes. Many times people, they tell me that no documentation is present for this tool, no help is present for this tool. No, everything is present, but it is little technical. If you go to the Selenium site and if you write download Selenium, you will actually go and see that the documentation of Selenium is out here in Java docs. Okay, if you click on this link, then you will actually see the Java docs are present over here. This is the documentation of Selenium, but it is technical. It is completely object oriented in nature. So until or unless you don't know the concept of object oriented programming, right, you will not be able to understand Selenium. Okay, so what you can do is, we can actually start with the concept of OOPs, object oriented programming in Java language, right, and then we can move further. Now to start with it, you need to first create a project in Eclipse. Right click over here, go to new project. Okay, new project, select from here, under Java you will have the option Java project, right. When you click on next, and I'll name my project as day one. Next and finish. Now you will see this folder coming up over here, project day one. If you expand it, you will have a source folder and you will have the JRE system library and all under it. Okay, now inside the source folder, right, you store all your Java code. If I right click on this project, this is important. If I go to the properties, these all are the properties of this project. This is the location of this project. The location is actually inside September weekend folder which I have created. You can physically go to the path of this project. You can just copy this, go to the path, and you will see the day one project over here. Okay, under this day one you will have source folder which is actually visible inside your Eclipse. Other files and folders are not visible, right. I'll talk about these files and folders. Just don't delete anything, otherwise things can go wrong. This dot project file represents that this is an Eclipse project. Don't ever delete anything over here. Okay, now in your project you can see this JRE system library. This is actually Java which got installed in your system. Fine. Now inside the source folder, I am going to create a new class called Java class. And how do you do that? Right click new class. Okay, right click on the source folder. Right. You can create a new class called say sample underscore Java underscore program, right. Click on this checkbox public static void main. Just click on that and click on finish, and you will see that you get a bit program like this. I just increase my font size so that you are able to see clearly on my machine. Hold on. Right, so this is the code which gets auto generated. Fine. What is public, what is class, static, void, just don't get confused over this. As we proceed with the course and the concepts of object oriented programming language, all these things they will be clear to you. Okay, so now what I am going to do is that in this is the class. Okay, this is a Java class. In this class you have the main function. Just like C language, you have the main function, right? I'll tell you what static and all these things are, right? Before that, to print anything in Java, the command is system.out.println, hello. So if you write system.out.println, then this will type hello. And if you run this program, you can right click over here, go here and run as Java application. This will simply execute your program. Fine. Now, please remember, Java is a case sensitive language. Even if I give S small over here, I'll get an error. And this is the error. Eclipse immediately tells you the error. That's the advantage of Eclipse as an editor. Okay. And it will tell you system cannot be resolved or something like that. So please make sure that you're giving writing it correctly. The shortcut for writing system.out.println is that you type SYSO and then hit control plus spacebar. Okay, so if you write SYSO and hit control spacebar, this thing comes up. Okay, now I am assuming in the course that you have a little knowledge of programming. At least you know what if statements are, right? What for loops are, what functions are, these three things. If you don't know what these three things are, then you can go to my site qtpselenium.com. Okay, you can go on this link over here and just a minute. When you go to this link, you will see that you can, these first two modules are open to everybody. Okay, just watch the Java training module 1 and 2. This has got basic knowledge on what Java is, what if statements, for loops and all everything is. What I am going to teach you out here is the concepts of object-oriented programming in Java. I am going to start. Okay, now let's start with it. Now in this file, when I execute this file, it prints hello. Right? If I right click over here and say run as Java application, this is printing hello. Fine. If you actually go to the physical location of this project, that is right click, go to the properties, go to the physical location of this project, you will see that under the source folder, you have the Java file which you just created. Okay. Under the bin folder, you have the class file. What is the class file? What happens is, when you write a Java program, a .java file you make. Okay. This Java file, when the program gets compiled, this gets converted into dot class file, and this dot is your executable file. If I open up this class file, I will not be able to see anything, I will not be able to understand anything. Every Java file is converted to a class file. Suppose I create another Java file over here called sample2. I'm sorry for that background noise if you are getting it, because that's really irritating me right now a lot. Okay, so if I write in this test and I run this, the program can also be executed with the help of this button on the top. Okay, you can click on this button and this will print test. Right, and if you look at the bin folder, you will see that for sample class 2 as well, there is a class file generated. Now, if I end up making 1000 Java files, I end up making 1000 class files. If I have to deliver the client all class files, what are the options with me? I can zip all the class files in using WinZip or WinRAR. I can make a zip file and ask, give it to the client. Right, but in Java we call it as a jar file, J-A-R. What we do is that we have a project, we have got number of class files in that project. Okay, and what practically we do is that we combine all the class files together and put them in a single file known as a jar file in Java. And we deliver them to the client, and client can use those jar files. Dot jar file. This is how you also get Selenium. When you, I have heard many times people telling me, can I install? How can I install Selenium in my workspace in Eclipse? There is nothing known as installing Selenium. Okay, you have to download and configure Selenium in Eclipse. Selenium has got nothing, but there are certain set of jar files which get downloaded on your machine when you download Selenium. For example, under this JRE system library, this is what? This is Java which was installed on your system. If you expand this, this is nothing but a set of jar files. Okay, and Java is not nothing but set of jar files, and each jar file is having many class files in it. All these classes are readily available to you for use. Okay, there are lot of things. Right? Now these jar files, they came up in your system and they got attached with your project when you installed Java. Similarly, the person who made Selenium, okay, made lot of Java files, put all those Java files in jar files and made it available to you. So when you go to the Selenium website, if I go to Google and if I write over here download Selenium, if I go here and just click on the download Selenium link out here, you will see that, sorry, you will see a javadoc link over here, okay, and a download link. When you click on this download link, you will have Selenium downloaded on your machine. It will come as a jar file. When you extract it, you will get a folder like this. For example, this is the version which I am having, the latest version of Selenium. When you open the folder after downloading that jar file, you will have two jar files over here. Selenium Java 2.4.1, whatever, two jar files over here. And inside the libs folder, you will have many other jar files. These are the jar files of Selenium. Selenium has got no executable file. There is no exe file in Selenium. Each and every of the jar files has got many classes, inbuilt classes, similarly like classes like sample Java program and samples like created over here. Similar to these, there are lots of classes in these jar files. Now you need to include these jar files in your current project to configure Selenium in your current project. Similar to the way that you have included the JRE, like the Java jar files here. For doing that, okay, you need to again right click on your project. This is how you configure Selenium in your project. I am teaching you how to configure them. So you have to right click on your project, go to the properties, go to Java build path over here, right, go to the library section, right. I will again explain, I will again tell you. I am recording this session, I will send you the recorded session as well. Right click on the project, go to the properties, go to Java build path libraries and click on add external jars button over here. Okay, you will get this button, add external jars. You click on this and you select the jar files. make sure you include these two jar files and also the jar files in lib folder. People do this mistake, they forget the folder, they just include these two jar files and then things do not work. You have to include the jar files in the lib folder as well. Control A, select everything, click on OK, and you will have a new section called reference libraries out here. Under this you will have the jar files of Selenium. Each and every jar file will have lot of class files in them. Okay, now this is how you configure Selenium in your system. Okay, but to work with Selenium, you actually need to know the concepts of object-oriented programming in Java language. You just can't straight away and go with Selenium, don't make that mistake, fine. So we have learned how to configure Selenium in Eclipse. Now we'll see how to learn the concept of object-oriented programming, fine. For that, I'll just create a new class called, say, house. Okay, a new class house.java. I will not keep the, remember I am not keeping the main function in it. So this is just a simple class called house. Okay, in this house class I'll keep a variable called string address. Okay, or a simple variable called int house number. Okay, so this is the house class and this is the house number. So I am starting with the concepts of object oriented programming now. Fine, I will come back to Selenium in some time. Right, and I will create a new class called test house. Okay, now if you actually go and create the object of house class in this. What do you mean by creating the object? So now we are learning how to create object of a class. You just have to write like this, new house, this is the syntax, and the object of that class will be generated. What do you mean by object? Okay, I can write it any number of times. Three objects have been created. What do you mean by an object? In memory, what happens is that if I write like this, then three memory locations they come up. Okay, and every memory location will have a variable called house number inside it. Three objects in the memory would be formed, and all the three objects will have the variable house number in it. But these are hanging objects. You cannot access these objects. Okay, did anybody ping me? I'm sorry, I missed it. Can you please ping me again if anybody from the class is ping me? Okay, so now these three are hanging objects. Object can be associated or we can be accessed with object references. If I write house H1 equals to new house, house H2 equals to new house, house H3 equals to new house. If I write like this, then what happens? In the memory, you get three references to the objects, three handles. The first one is known as H1, second is H2 and H3. H1, H2 and H3 are not objects, they are references, they are known as object references. This is the object. Okay, with object references you can access the object. For example, if I write H1 dot, you will see the house number option coming up over here. I'll write H1 dot house number is 100, and similarly H2 and H3 dot house numbers are 200 and 300. So what will happen in memory is that this house number will have value 100, this will have 200, and this will have 300. Okay, if I go Look, the variable is just one. In my house class, I just have got one variable house number. But by creating multiple objects of that class, I can initialize that variable to different values. Every object will have its own set of variables. Now, if I write system.out.println h1 dot house number, h2 dot house number, and h3 dot house number. If I run this, it will print 100, 200, and 300. Okay, now what is the difference between this object and a reference? H1, H2, H3 are references, and these lines are creating objects. Whenever you write new house, it creates objects. If I write on the next line H2 equals to H3, okay, and just hold on. If I write H2 equals to H3 and I print V, what will happen is that in the memory, this H2 will be removed from here. It will now point towards this H3. It will point towards the same object to which H3 is pointing to. Okay? And if I print the three lines again, you will get the output 100, 200, 300, and 100, 300, and 300. Because H2 is now pointing towards the place where H3 is pointing. Right? And if H, now in this, if I write, in this, if I write out here H2 dot, okay, H2 is changing the house number, okay. I write H2 dot house number, hold on, let me just move my screen, widen it, right. If I change the house number of H2 to 400 now, okay, and I again go and print the output and run this code, it will print 100, 400, 400. For H3 as well, the house number which is printed is equal to 400. These two things are printing 400. Why? Because in the memory, H2 and H3 are pointing towards the same object. H2 changes the house number to 400. When you extract the house number with H3, it gets 400. It extracts 400. So this is what objects are. Okay? These are what objects are. Every object has its own state. Fine. Every object has got certain like properties inside it. Now if I declare one more property called, just a minute guys, give me 1 minute. Every object will have an address property inside it. Okay, every object will have an address property inside it, and every object can have a different address. Every house can have a different address. Okay, right. Now similarly, in the house class, I can create functions. I can write a function called say public void print number. So this function will just print the house number. Okay, and in the test house function, I can create the objects of that house class, right? And I can call h1 dot print house number and h2 and h3 dot print house number. Now this function also will have the print house number function will also have one copy inside every house. This object, this will have a print house number, this will have a print number function, this will have. When you call this print number function, it should print the house number of this particular object. When you call this print number function, it will print this particular object's house number, and so on so forth. Okay, so if you run this, this will again print in the end the same thing, 100, 400 and 400. Function is same, but it is being called by different objects. The object which calls this function, the house number of that particular object is printed. Okay, right. I am assuming within this course that you have a little knowledge of what functions are, what parameters are, what are return types and all. If you still don't have, there is nothing to worry. You can go to my site after the class and you can watch the first two videos on the website, video 1 and video 2, then you will have a very good idea from that. Okay, now okay, in this just one class, I'll just change my status to invisible. Now in this you can also, I'll just create a new class called sample Selenium. Okay, now in Selenium everything is inbuilt. For example, I made this file called as house.java, but in Selenium everything is inbuilt. If you go to the downloads page in the Java docs, right, you will have a file called as Firefox driver over here. Okay, this class is an inbuilt class inside Selenium. Those who made Selenium made this class. Okay, when you create the object of this class, what happens is that if I write new Firefox driver, I'm creating the object of that class. This class is actually present somewhere in the jar files of Selenium which you have downloaded in your workspace. Okay, if I move my mouse over this class and select the option import Firefox driver, you can import this class. You can import this from the jar file. Okay, and when you run this program, you will see a blank Firefox window opening up. You see that? This blank Firefox window, it opens up. Right? Similarly, if you write, if I declare a handle to it, I write Firefox driver F1 equals to new Firefox. I am creating the object and giving it an object reference F1. And if I write F1 dot you will get actually the all the URL, sorry, you can specify the URL over here, the website to which you want to go to. Firefox driver F1 equals to new Firefox driver F1.get. Okay, specify the website gmail.com and that Firefox will navigate to Gmail. If you run this, this will actually open Firefox and take it to Gmail. Okay, now again if I write, I create another object of Firefox driver F2 and I just write Yahoo over here and I run the code, this will open two Firefox browsers. One will go to Gmail, other will go to Yahoo. Hold on. So it opens, if you run this, right, it will open Firefox, right, it will go to the home page of Gmail, and if you again run this, now again one more Firefox will open up. Okay, this will go to Yahoo. Hold on. Oh, sorry, I should have been written f2.get. F2 is this object. Okay, so hold on. If you run this again, two browsers will open. First one will go to Gmail, the second one will go to Yahoo. Similarly to Firefox driver, there are other classes like Chrome driver, Internet Explorer driver. You need to create the objects of those classes to work with them. So you see this, the first browser has gone to Gmail and the second browser has gone to Yahoo. Okay, now let's do one thing, let's take a 10 minutes break. Right? We'll start at 10:05, it's now 9:55. We'll start at 10:05, let's take a 10 minutes break. Okay, I'll start after that. Meanwhile, if anybody has any questions,